So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all today for e-conference on chemical industry, accelerating India's growth story amidst challenges, organized by Indian Chemical News. So myself, Praveen Prashant, editor Indian Chemical News, will be your host and moderator for today's e-conference. So let me brief you about ICN. Next slide. Indian Chemical News, or ICN in short form, is a digital platform for senior level decision makers in the chemical industry, organic, inorganic, petrochemicals, gas, dye stuffs, dye intermediates, fertilizers, pesticides, specialty chemicals, paints, plastics, etc. We primarily want to be the primary source for information for companies, policymakers, regulatory bodies, technology vendors, solution providers, industry bodies, academia, R&D institutes, startups, and PR. What we are trying to do is, and our USP is, in-depth coverage through news, analysis, trends, columns, tech updates, interview, reports, and others. We are what we can say, part of Sindhu Media Private Limited, a new age media group that focuses on knowledge dissemination through Indian Chemical News and DJ Analysis website, daily newsletters, publishing research-led reports, organizing industry events, conducting e-conferences, and others. It also has a repository of video-led content. Total unique visitors is 18.5K, total page views is 45.4K, and the newsletter subscribers is 12.7K. So how do we move? We will have a brief introductory remarks by all speakers on the current assessment of Indian chemical industry for 2 to 3 minutes, followed by panel discussion and Q&A. I would like to highlight that these audiences, please feel free to ask questions pertaining to the topic by clicking on the chat window at the bottom of your screen, and please type your questions during e-conference. We will take Q&A at the end of the panel discussion. The speakers for today's e-conference is Mr. Rajiv Kumar, President, Atul Limited, and Managing Director, Amal Limited. Mr. Suhab Rais, Chief Operating Officer, Indian Chemicals Business, Tata Chemicals Limited. Mr. Adnan Ahmed, Vice Chairman and Managing Director, Clariant India. Mr. Ravi Kapoor, Managing Director, Hubac India. Mr. S. Ganeshan, Vice President, Agri Policies and Outreach, UPL Limited. Mr. Swarnabh Mukherjee, Principal Analyst, Chemical Sector, Edelweiss Broking Limited. Let me give a brief introduction, and then I will ask all my speakers to speak one by one. The outbreak of COVID-19 and the resultant lockdown has disrupted the global supply chain and manufacturing of the chemicals industry. Manufacturers are facing supply chain interruptions and global travel restrictions, in addition to the quarantine workforce, which is the new terminology during COVID-19. Majority of companies have either reduced production or temporarily shut down their plants, and now they have started opening up their plants. SMEs engaged in the manufacturing of chemicals are being hit hard, as India braces for a decline in volume. On the positive side, demand for products used in the manufacturing of sanitizing products, personal protection, and health care remained upbeat, and even production of fertilizers and agrochemicals were not impacted. Just to take from Swarnabh's report from Edelweiss, the Indian chemical industry is presently positioned in front of a set of developments that would result in strong growth opportunities in both the overseas and domestic markets for Indian players, strong demand from downstream industries, and a trend of shift in supply chain from China are the key factors to watch out as part of the tailwind. You will hear more on this from Mr. Swarnabh Mukherjee, Edelweiss Broking. The discussion points for today's e-conference is managing supply chain disruptions, enhancing chemical value chain through raw material manufacturing, adopting increased automation for increased efficiency, managing logistics, tapping new opportunities, increasing revenue and profitability, and creating chemical economist ecosystem where everybody benefits. Today, we have an eminent set of speakers amongst us, all industry veterans from the chemical industry, and they will share their valuable opinion on how to accelerate India's growth story in the chemical industry. So let me start with Mr. Rajiv Kumar and President Atul and Managing Director, Amal Limited, with a brief on the company. just two lines on Atul and Amal. Atul is an integrated chemical company serving about 6,000 customers belonging to about 27 industries. And Amal Limited is an India-based company engaged in offering basic chemicals. So over to you, Mr. Rajiv Kumar, for your introductory remarks, sir. Mr. Rajiv Kumar, President.
You're on mute, Rajiv. You're on mute.
Sushil, please unmute Mr. Rajiv Kumar, or if you can unmute yourself.
Yeah, you can hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, thank you, Praveen. So I would like to start beginning with a one optimistic statement that every problem we have in life, it makes us stronger and throws new opportunities. So even current COVID-19 pandemic, it has thrown many challenges to us. But I believe that it brings many new opportunities, especially for Indian chemical industry. So with that, we just start with the discussion there that now when we are talking so much about what will happen in future, what will happen to our chemical industry. So with the basic model, what we are talking, the three scenarios we are discussing about. The first one is that V-curve recovery, where we believe that it will be that all that COVID for the short term and with the limited impact. And very soon we will be back on track and with the normal growth, everything will be okay. The second, what we are discussing about U-shaped curve, where we know that we will be partly successful, but it will have its limited impact, let's say for a quarter or for 3-4 months. But after that, it will be a fast recovery. And the third one is, which is basically many people are talking, is the pessimistic, which people believe that by end of this fiscal, that is up to March 21, that it will be difficult to control, then only we will usher in new world. With last 2 months data and facts what we have available with us, that clearly tells us that we have started most of the plant and we have ramped up our utilization rate. So if you see the PMI index, what was in April, we don't talk about, it was nothing working. In May, it was around 30%. In June, it jumped to 47%. With the market, what expecting only 37%, now it is at 47%. That clearly tell us that we are somewhere in the U-shaped recovery of our Indian chemical industry. This brings us a lot of scope of improvement in terms of whatever the good happening in the industry, that we really work on it. Like one of the aspects is that agrochemicals, last our production in agro, it was really record one. Even with good monsoon also, we expect that there will be good demand for the agrochemicals also. But having said all that, there are specific cases for a specific segment also. If you talk about textile, paper, or leather, it is struggling with many challenges. So there we have to do something different. Otherwise, most of other segments are doing okay and ramping up. Another important segment what we have to focus on is MSME. MSME is very integral part of our, especially chemical industry. What happens if the MSME not working, the big chemical plants, then they don't have a demand in the market. So apart from the government, whatever they are doing to support them, it is the responsibility of the big players also to support them. And truly, if that chain works out, then it will be good for the big players and overall the chemical industry will be better in position. So with that, I just finish it over and we can more talk later when we go for the discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Rajiv Kumar, for your overview. I would now request Mr. Sohab Rais, Chief Operating Officer, Indian Chemical Business, Tata Chemicals. Just a brief on Tata Chemicals. Tata Chemicals is a global company with focus on basic chemistry products, consumer and specialty products. So over to Mr. Sohab Rais.
Thank you, Mr. Prashant, for your kind introduction. Before I give my opening remarks, I would like to thank the Indian Chemical News and Mr. Praveen Prashant for providing me and Tata Chemicals this opportunity to be on the panel to discuss the most critical area of chemical industry, that is accelerating India growth story amidst challenges. So to begin with, I would like to talk about the COVID and the impact of the COVID that the industry witnessed in the end of March and early April, May kind of period. Although there were significant disruptions at various places, our operations that were supporting essential products like edible salt and sodium bicarbonate going to food, feed and pharma sectors, also the soda ash, which goes to detergent sector, started opening up much earlier. In fact, our edible salt never shut. We were trying to optimize it to more than 100% capacity level right in the beginning, because essentials were allowed. And we could see opening up a little earlier than the normal opening up that the industry witnessed. With a market size of about $163 billion in FY18, globally we are the sixth largest chemical producers as a country. And this contributes to about 3.5% of global industry size. Soda ash is about 8,000 crore industry, which is highly capital intensive and having a long gestation period. We are about 6% of global capacity and also about slightly 6.5% of global demand share. What do you feel that with this current situation, a very clear focus on expeditiously clearing trade cases to protect various industries from predatory and dumping prices, a cluster approach to develop integrated large-scale chemical industrial zones at strategic location with port access, smooth land allocation and faster land allocation, competitive funding and easy access to marketplace would be some of the key areas that could help achieve accelerated growth. If you see the significant amount of current demand for chemicals in India is met with imports, almost about 3 lakh crore at a CAGR of 16% growth over the last about 12 years. And that gives a very, very clear idea of import substitution under both Make in India and Atmanirbhar initiatives. This will help us drive home advantage for our domestic industry and through substitution, getting into very high growth for the domestic industry. With that, back to you, Mr. Prashant.
Thank you, Mr. Sohab Rais. I would now request Mr. Adnan Ahmed, Vice Chairman and Managing Director, Clariant India, to speak. Just a word on Clariant India. It is the world's leading specialty chemical companies and does a lot of innovation in cutting-edge technology. So over to Mr. Adnan Ahmed.
Thank you, Praveen. So I'll try and not repeat some of the things that were said earlier, but I think I just want to start by saying that the chemical industry remains to be a really attractive sector for opportunities for us. Yeah, so sorry, yeah, just give me a minute. I've just got something. Yeah, thank you. So yeah, it's I just want to make three or four key points here. One is regarding the opportunities that are coming in the near term because of what's happening in China. I think we're all seeing that. So before COVID, there was rising cost of labor. There were, you know, environmental issues in China for shutdowns and so on. But something has changed now, and there's some trade-related supply disruptions as well. So that's a big opportunity for us. The third point is about India by itself. India stands to save an import bill of nearly $3 billion by manufacturing locally. And, you know, even if you look at if you just look at the size of our businesses in India today, we're the sixth largest chemical manufacturer globally. So we've got a lot of capabilities in this country. And we are importing, we just heard huge amounts, I think some $12 billion are being imported. And India has a strong base in the main three export segments. You'll hear a little bit more about it later on today. So there's the agrochemicals, which is 27% of our specialty exports. There's dyes and pigments, which is another 19%. And then there's intermediates for active pharmaceutical ingredients, which is about 18%. And all these three areas, we've got a lot of expertise in India. So big opportunity there. And the last point I want to make is actually probably the most important, which is for us to really start punching above our weight, we have to look ahead. We have to look at, you know, Industry 4.0. We have to look at automation. We have to look at a complete change in the way that this industry operates in India. Very often we are, you know, we think that it's being socially responsible to have lots of labor, very manual operations and so on. I think actually it's the opposite, because look at China. What they've done is they've improved the quality of jobs because they brought in automation. They've moved to Industry 4.0 and they've got really state-of-the-art manufacturing, which is why they're 10 times the size of India, whether it's in chemicals or even in the size of their industry. So there is a big focus in that space of technology, which India needs to drive, and also in safety and environment. We've had lots of incidents you may have seen since the shutdown in March, number of explosions, accidents, fatalities, which is not good for our industry, and it doesn't have to be. Our industry can actually be a very safe and responsible industry, beneficial to societies in which we operate in the you know, the rural areas where we operate. We can add a lot of value to those areas, and that's what we need to focus on. So I'm just going to leave it at that. Back to you, Prabhat.
Thank you, sir, for giving both the present scenario as well as the future scenario. Now I come to Mr. Ravi Kapoor, Managing Director, HUBAC India. Just a bit of information on HUBAC. It's a globally active pigment specialist, which provides a range of high quality inorganic, organic, colored pigments, anti-corrosive pigments, and pigment preparation. One more additional information is they are also a specialist in providing custom solutions with respect to the pigment part of it. So over to Mr. Ravi Kapoor, Managing Director, HUBAC India. Mr. Ravi Kapoor.
Good afternoon to everybody. I have to say it's a familiar panel. At least, you know, two of them I know, and the other gentleman, very good afternoon to you. Nice to meet you on cyberspace. Okay, thank you for the invitation. And always, as you go down the chain, you know, the issues are repeated. I'm also going to, like Adnan, try to bring some different angles to this. I think I'm going to just, if I look at the points that you've just put in, if I try to stick to that, from the first two points, which is managing supply chain and enhancing chemical value chain, a little bit both of these issues are linked. And for us as a company, I would like to give you a live example of how we are doing it and what we are doing in these particular times. So I think it should be interesting takeaway. But I think what's happening is, if you see historically, if you look at intermediates and certain chemicals which were produced in India as well as in Europe, about 15 years ago, the Chinese strategy was to drive away everybody by sheer volumes. When the volumes were reached, slowly, you know, you had all the competitors getting out. And once they got out, the Chinese came in back with the increased prices, etc. Right now, you have a strain. There is a kind of a monopoly in China, and you've had now cases where they have been shut, and we are now forced to really look at everything. Now, the present scenario, I think what it brings about is self-sufficiency, Atmanirbhar, what we say. I think it becomes key, because if you want to be a long-term player, many of these products or many of the products, especially in our line, and I'm sure it's true for specialties, you would have to backward integrate. You would have to go into the feedstocks, see where they're available from, and then really get into it. At Heubach, we are pursuing this strategy very clearly and very diligently. So what we are doing is, all our key raw materials, we are now setting up either plants or setting up manufacturing tolling arrangements, so that we are not really relying then on the Chinese supply mostly. And I think this is one of the big takeaways which has come about, you know, from this situation. So this answers both. You enhance your value chain by going backward. And also this whole supply chain issue, the supply chain was disrupted because of, as I said, there were accidents in China, there was enforcement of environmental, you know, norms, very strict norms in China. Both these led to a situation where it was, you know, then very disruptive. Add to this, of course, COVID, we had a situation where there was complete shutdown. We are happy to report that, you know, we started at about 50% right from May. and even April we could produce something. So we did manage. We have, of course, a pharma plant, and that helped us to get started. Now, regarding the point which Adnan raised, I think for the chemical industry, I don't have to stress how important the chemical industry is, because it's one of the industries which is common across. The stats are whether it is 15 or 16%, you know, to the Indian global story. If you look at the GDP and if you look at the chemical industry, it contributes to each and every sector. And each sector, the chemical industry, unfortunately, in that sense, has not been recognized. We have been from ICC talking a lot about it, whether we could kind of get a very clear focus, a chemical policy. And this policy, I think, by the government would go a long way, because it would affect all sectors. It would improve all sectors. And I think this is one of the key takeaways that I would leave, because, you know, I'm running out of time, that we need to focus on the chemical industry to grow all the industry.
Thank you, sir, for focusing on raw materials manufacturing in a big way, so that we can overcome the China factor part of it. Now I would request Mr. S. Ganeshan, Vice President, Agri Policies and Outreach, UPL Limited. Just a word on UPL. UPL is focused on emerging as a premium global provider of total crop solutions designed to secure the world's long-term food supply. So over to Mr. S. Ganeshan.
Okay, thank you, organizers, and thank you, participants, and
MEP. So would you, Shall I switch on your PPT?
Yeah, is my voice audible?
Yeah, voice is audible.
Okay, I'll take off from where Ravi Kopar left. It is time has come for the government to focus on chemical industry. And the couple of slides that I'll be showing will tell the strength
Sushil,
of the
Sushil, please please put the slide on.
Yeah. This is more for the benefit of people who are watching this program from all over the country. And pass quickly, go to the next one. Yes, so this is the kind of scenario, and as the title shows, a vibrant economy requires a vibrant chemical industry. If you look at the giants in the global economy, all of them have a vibrant chemical industry. Look at the numbers here. Now, US, this is a 2017 figure. It's about $19 trillion, and their chemical production is 765, and EU is $900 billion. And China, $1,500 billion. Where do we stand? India is just 150. One of the reasons why our economy is, the size of the economy, the size of the manufacturing sector is very, very bad, is that we have very, very narrow chemical production in the country. So if we really have to look at or look forward to achieving $5 trillion economy, the government has got no other option but to look at promoting the domestic production completely. Now, domestic chemical production will stimulate manufactured goods. Manufactured goods will stimulate the economy, both by providing the employment opportunities and increasing the GDP. Just 2 days ago, World Bank released the latest GDP data for India too. Now, the agriculture sector has grown up substantially. Output is 450, but manufacturing has shrunk. So the numbers from World Bank should open the eyes of policymakers. The last one is really important. Look at it. For every $1 generated by chemical industry, a further $4+ is generated elsewhere in the economy. So the kind of the effect that chemical industry can produce on the economy is huge, but this is not realized as yet by the common people and by the policymakers. Next slide, please. Yeah, look at it. Now, this is an interesting slide. You can see how the chemical exports is closely correlated with the world GDP. Look at it. There's a beautiful, unmistakable association. And if you see the left side, the chemical industry size was $3,300 billion 10 years in 2007. It has grown to $5.7 trillion, $5,700 billion now, and according to UN, this is going to double by 2030. So chemical industry is the mother of all industry. That is really driving the world GDP. And there is no reason why it should not be driving Indian GDP too. Next. Yes, this is the latest one from Government of India. Now look at the merchandise export. This is that there are two things. One is our own, the merchandise export for India in the financial year 1819 vis-a-vis 1920. Look at what is leading the merchandise export. It is chemicals. Now all others have lost out between 2018 to 2019. Look at the left hand side. It was petroleum crude that was leading the export in 18 and 19. That has come down considerably to 41. Now, the time has come to put it shortly for the government, for the policymakers to look at chemical industries in a very, very big way in order to stimulate the economy. Now, the speaker spoke about COVID and impact. In fact, we are seeing a lot of fast recovery from COVID. Those of you who have been watching the GST collection, India's GST collection for May was 62,000 crores. It is up to 92,000 crores now. On an average, if you go with the last year data, it's about 1,10,000 crores average. So we are pretty close to last year's monthly average. So sky is the limit for the growth if only the policymakers look at chemical industry in a big way. Next. I have two more slides. So, one more. Go back. Yes. Now look at, this is the world scenario. The world export of chemicals very high. This is the WTO data. 2,219. Although chemical exports from India rank the top, it is very, very low. We have a long way to go and we have huge opportunities. Here we given in this slide, chemical exports and what is the rank share of India, puny. Even in pharmaceuticals, look at the share of Europe. They have a share of 67%, massive share. In case of pesticides, which where I come from, they have 50% of the world share. So we have a huge opportunity in chemical industry, but it is not tapped to the extent it ought to be tapped. That's a message that I would like to give, share through this. Next one, I think we have a couple of questions. Okay, this shows the rank of India in agrochemicals export. Look, our rank is 5. And of course, ahead of us, we have China, USA, Germany, France, and all. Not too many. As I said, it's like 50% of agrochemical export is from EU. I have one more slide to show, then I'll stop. I'll take next. Yes, that shows the kind of consistent trade surplus posted by India's agrochemical industry. Thank you very much. I think the purpose of sharing this data is to bring the true size and importance of chemical industry. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ganeshan, for giving an overview about the chemical as well as agrochemical part of it. Now I request Mr. Swarnabh Mukherjee, Principal Analyst, Chemical Sector, Edelweiss Broking Limited. Swarnabh, we have given you the chance of listening to everybody and then give your final viewpoints. Just a brief on Edelweiss. It is one of India's leading diversified financial services conglomerate with broad range of product and services. Over to Mr. Swarnabh Mukherjee. Swarnabh? Hello? Yeah, I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Ravindji, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Please go ahead.
Oh, thank you so much. Afternoon to all the participants and
please put your video on.
So
put your video on. Swarnabh, please put your video on.
Actually, having some difficulty, the Zoom app is disconnecting when I'm turning the video on. So that's why
So we will listen to your audio, sir.
Sure. Thank you. Oh. I think the August presenter.
Swarna, please go ahead. Hello. I think he has disconnected. So what we will do is we will straight away go to the panel discussion, and when he joins in, we will get his views. So the topic for today's panel discussion is chemical industry accelerating India's growth story amidst challenges. So we have heard from everybody, all the speakers, about the challenges part of it, and also the how do we plan to accelerate. So I would request all my speakers if they can talk about three things which will help India to accelerate in days to come. To start with, I will ask Mr. Rajiv Kumar to start. Mr. Rajiv Kumar?
Yeah. So to begin with, the three things what we have taken into consideration. That the first one is that to deal with this COVID-19, one of the important thing is to be prudent on the finance management. With all supply chain difficulty, whether it is a raw material, we plan the raw material as a normal way, and then there is some problem. And if you take the specific case of the nowadays in China, then it is too much of a problem. Our production is get lost in that. Similar situation is in FG also. We plan for the export, the ship sailing time and all that. It is all so much volatile that it is a problem getting the raw material or exporting our finished goods material. Now, what we can do that whatever the situation is there, now we take it as a new normal. Suppose a product coming from the China and we used to make some certain inventory of 15 days and all that. We have to now critically examine and review our raw material inventory. So wherever the problem is there, we have to now keep the more inventory over there. But at the same time, for the raw material which is easily available, we have to be more stricter on that, so that our total chunk of the raw material portfolio, we don't increase the working capital. Similar basis is the for the finished good also. For the finished goods, sometimes we have too much of inventory because we can't do the export at that time. Our customer is facing some problem. So we have to be top on the job every time is there. If something is not accepted or not possible for the supply chain, how we can cater to some other so that our overall the production line, our inventory, warehouse, it is very much scheduled as per our the production capability. Now, another thing, what I believe that actually in all this corona things or any other problem, what we need is a return muscle. A return muscle is nothing actually, it is any enterprise ability to absorb all these uncertainties and quickly convert all these lessons into the operating model. So whatever happening, we just can't wait and watch policy. We have to find our own unique solution for that. Whatever the new idea, so there are general ideas given by the government, industry player, many other things are there. But what something is very unique to our chemical industry, we have to find our own way. And whoever is that implementing the first. Of course, there are risks associated with that. But if something which I can do first in that, I will be a path breaker for many. So that will lead to that company into different ball game. This is something we have to do to fight with this situation. That is the solution. And when coming back to our expansion, and when we are talking that in new raw material, what has been happened till today in India, we have been very much dissociated from the chemical value chain. One company looking for that, this is my backward integration, this is my forward integration, and all that is there. So if you see right from NAFTA to end consumer product, there are so many the missing link, and many that the big commodity product which we are today importing, and that is what all this big number of import chemical imported comes is there. Talk about acetic acid. talk about formic acid. Now we have to think very differently. The time has gone, and China also did one time the same way, that they leapt into all these new molecule that time, now which has become a commodity. We have to think, we come out of our own shell now, okay, this is only my specialty, only I can do that, and think that what big I can do. And I am very, very hopeful that today our current government is looking for that. How we can change this profile of Indian chemical industry? It is not just some very special chemical segment which is too much dependent on the imported material and all those things. We have the complete value chain in the Indian chemical industry, so that we are self-dependent, or the favorite word by PM Modi, Atmanirbhar. So that's what we can do with all this. Thank you. You are on mute, Praveen.
Now I would request, thank you, Mr. Rajiv Kumar. Now I would request Mr. Suhab Rais to speak, sir.
Thank you. I think I briefly touched on some of the points in my inaugural address. However, I would like to talk about three points which are very important. We talked about there's a gap between demand and supply and import dependence for chemicals in India. And now when we are talking about Atmanirbhar, so there has to be a very clear focus on Atmanirbhar. Maybe a special ministry or a department could be formed for that, which will look into various chemicals and which can look into the what could be substituted in India, how we will do, who are the major players, what are the capacities, what are the export opportunities. Very clearly, some analysis could be done, and then support could be done. So looking at what are the additional capacities and how do we scale up? Scaling up is extremely important for being Atmanirbhar and also for increasing the growth for chemicals in India. So these are some of the things with, I think, with single-minded focus of building capacity, scaling up could be done. Second would be fast-tracking all the trade disputes for whichever countries they are there. This is important because it will help the domestic industry to stop bleeding. So wherever the domestic industry is bleeding, they also shy away from further investments. So investments is important, industry health is important, and we should not let the exporters from other countries see it as a field day here and start dumping material at predatory prices, huge volumes, which will disrupt the market totally. So that would be the second point, which is very important. And third point, especially for chemicals, it is important is because chemical has got two, three specific areas, which puts it into some disadvantage. One is that it needs a lot of clearances, environment clearance, lot of areas. And it is also sometimes seen as a not a very healthy industry. So that's a perception matter. So for that, it is, and also many of the chemical industries and project, large projects need a lot of investments and the project time is very high. So how do we collapse the entire project execution time? So that is very important to concentrate and take out issues and address each of the issues. How do we collapse? How do we give faster land allocations? Large lands are required. How do we give allocation faster? How do we clear all the requirements that are required, including environment places? Currently, there are many multiple agencies where the industry has to go for clearances. So is it possible to ensure that there is a single committee, whether it is sea, whether it is environment, whether it is forest, whether it is all clearances required, only one committee, expert committee, all the experts which are required could be part of that committee. But one committee will do the things. So I think these are the three points, top points I thought would be important to address. Back to you, Prashant.
Thank you, Mr. Suhab Rais. Now I would request Mr. Swarnav Mukherjee, who has joined in. So Swarnav, if you can talk about.
Yes, sure. So I'm audible now, right?
Yeah, you are audible. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So I just want to put a couple of points out here regarding the growth that we expect to see in the sector going forwards. So Indian chemical sector over the last few years have grown at a healthy rate. But now I think there are more levers in place which would, you know, help this to fructify at a much higher level. So now a couple of trends that might emerge and already we are seeing that emerging. First of all, I would like to look at the domestic side of the thing. Growing consumption in the domestic market is resulting in burgeoning domestic demand. And this coupled with, as our, several of the panelists have mentioned earlier, a focus towards, de-risking oneself from overseas raw material imports would be factors which would drive setting up of domestic capacities and undertaking of import substitution. We have seen several companies, particularly in the listed area that I track more closely, several companies have come up with import substitute products. And government policies, I think, going forwards would be an enabler for this growth, not in terms of only, revenue generation, which will emanate from the higher demand and a larger bouquet of products, but also in terms of development of common infrastructure for these companies, which should help in reduce costs and improve the profitability. So initiatives like PCPIR zones or the recently announced bulk drug parks related policies could help us achieve the same if executed in the intended manner. And that would also help to streamline the supply chain and aid in the development of the logistics network that we require in India. Additionally, what we see is that, companies have risen up to this demand. Capacity expansions has been done consistently and over the last few years, and I think several expansions are in progress, and many of those would also be on the drawing board of companies. So I think from the capacity point of view, as we move forwards, companies would be in a better position to capture this growth that we anticipate. Alongside the domestic story, what we envisage is also that the quantum of exports should increase, particularly because global players would like to diversify now their sourcing, and this could be a broad shift that may come in the global supply chain, and this would also help. Prior participants have already mentioned about what has happened in China, and that could be a trigger. But overall, I think for the sustainability of the supply chain, this could be a trend that we see. Now, also finally, looking at the near-term scenario, I think COVID-19 situation had over the last 3-4 months thrown up some challenges, and there were some roadblocks in growth over the last 2-3 months, but things are moderating now, and companies utilization levels of companies, particularly in the essential side, has improved significantly, and we are very hopeful that things will continuously improve and get back to pre-COVID levels pretty soon. There are some bright spots that have emerged in subsectors like pharma, health and hygiene, and now with a forecast of a good monsoon, there could be strong growth in the agrochemical side of the industry as well. So these could enable our overall industry to keep track of the growth path and then revert to a strong growth path that we have envisaged at a pre-COVID period. A couple of other things that it would help is probably, I think, streamlining the supply chain and bringing in digitization and automation because of all the norms that have come in terms of social distancing to comfortably run the operations of these companies. So these are the broad points that I wanted to make. And now I would hand it back to Praveen. Thank you.
Thank you, Swarnav. Now I would request Mr. Adnan Ahmed. Sir, you are on mute.
Mr. Ahmed, you are on mute.
Yeah, if you can unmute.
Sorry, I just said lots of things to myself. I'm going to talk about three areas of what we can do to make the best of the situation that we have right now. But the first area that I want to talk about is an area which is where we have to do something in the industry. And this is irrespective of whether there's COVID or not, but it's something that we have to do if we want to really leapfrog going forward. And that's in the area of safety and environment. Absolutely, we have to be responsible, we have to self-regulate, we have to make sure that we are not we're not creating a business model by cutting costs and not investing in safety and so on. We cannot have this fatalistic view, and we must have our eyes open and see that we have a problem here. Yeah. And we've seen the number of incidences that have happened over the last 3-4 months is very disturbing. It's not good for our industry, and it doesn't have to happen. Every one of these accidents can be prevented. We must invest in safety and managing the environment. So this is the first area which we have to invest in. And it is the cost of doing business, of being in our business, right? It's a cost. You cannot avoid it. And people who are trying to shortcut must be dealt with. And we've got to regulate in the industry, not allow that. The second one is around modernization. I think Swarnab also talked about that. And I mentioned it earlier. And it's really looking at Industry 4.0. What we have to look at is, we have to be more self-reliant in the industry as well. We cannot have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people coming in, because that adds to safety-related issues. It adds to quality-related issues. It adds to, we're still in Industry 2.0, and now everybody's talking about 4.0. So we need to skip the 3.0, which was all about the robotics and, automating things that are done over and over again. We need to now move into the next phase, which is more intelligent, artificial intelligence, looking at data analytics and so on. See, the government has supported creating a world-class automotive sector and a world-class IT sector, which is probably not so much government related, but these are two sectors that India has been world-class in. We need a little bit of a nudge to be world-class in the chemical industry as well, and it needs this modernization. And somebody was asking about scale and so on. It will come through this modernization. We cannot do it through pots and pans and hundreds of people working around our industries. So what will then happen is that, we feel that we're not socially responsible by giving everybody jobs. But in the longer term, if we become like China and we, scale up our industry, we'll have better quality jobs. So we will have lots of jobs, but they will be better quality jobs. And that's what we need to go towards. And the last one is about the support from the government. And everybody's going to say this over and over again. We need support in infrastructure. We need support in getting clearances. We need differentiation. Those of us who are investing in ZLDs, who are investing in safety and environment, please treat us differently. Don't treat everybody the same. We need to invest ourselves in things like responsible care, which is a very, very good program, which all of us need to do in the industry. And, we need to have things that the government has announced need to be done well, like Skill India and so on. So I'll just leave it at that. So these are the three areas which I think are really important for us to exploit going forward. Back to you, Praveen.
Thank you, Mr. Adnan Ahmed. Now I would request Mr. Ravi Kapoor. Mr. Ravi Kapoor.
Yeah. Okay. Again, Adnan has taken one of the topics, which is responsibility. But since it is so important, I forgive him for that. Yeah. I can repeat a little bit and stress. But I would say I would also take two or three points. One of the points which is at least needs to be stressed, if you really look at also the initiative of various governments, we talk really of new investments. We always say, let's really do a summit and then have new investments there. Now, I'm always saying that the lowest hanging fruit, because any investment in chemical industry has a gestation of 2 to 3 years, if not more, maybe 3 or 4 or 5 years. You start investing, taking a decision, you see product in 3 years, they call it a 1,000-day cycle, this happens. I'm always trying to request government, to work with industry, that you really unshackle the existing capacities which are not used. So the lowest hanging fruit here are capacities which are existing either in MSMEs or in the larger industries where they are not being utilized. Now you can really go into why they are not being utilized. It could be due to regulatory issues, environmental issues, specific problems with entire region being banned for expansion because of, SEPI scores. All these can be taken, but if together with industry, taken. This is the lowest hanging, easiest, quick return, and a no-brainer according to me, because according to me today, you have industry working at on an average at 50-60%. There is 30-40% available to you to unchain. This for me is one of the most important ones. The second point is that what you also need to do is to take a leaf out of China in some ways, and always we quote China because they have a successful model. But we missed out on the cluster development. When you really look at cluster development with the feedstock company coming, you know, whether you want to call it the key industry or whatsoever as in PCPIR, but clusters even in sub areas, for example, in pigments and dyes, one of the most heartening statistics is which not bought out is that the import and export is similar, which means that there is no deficit there in pigments and dyes. If you include intermediates going out, intermediates coming in, finished products going in and out. So this is a sector where I think in the world you would have maybe something like 10% of the world market. It's absolutely possible to double it. And this is again should be identified, not because I'm a pigment guy, but you can take and identify other sectors as well, where you can take these sectors, concentrate on it, make a white paper, do the cluster development where required. You know, this is something which again is for me a no-brainer. The third one is there is a tendency in industry to kind of club in a region. If you look at the western part of India, you say Maharashtra and Gujarat takes about 70-75% of India's chemical industry. Now Orissa has come up, West Bengal has come up, Kakinada has come up, but if you see the growth of industry there, now we as industry leaders, I think also have an obligation that we really look at these regions. Somebody has to make the move, somebody has to go there. If you look at the stress and strain which is there on in Gujarat, for instance, on the water, on the power, on all those issues, and in Maharashtra as well, that actually leads to a lot of problems, you know, and this is again one area where we kind of decentralize. It's too much focus on one side of India. You have to go to the other part as well. Finally, my favorite topic, which is responsible care, nicer globe. Now, this takes more significant, just not the environment, but what happens is that if you don't want to grow the industry to the scale of the industry, how are you going to double it if every day you're going to hear, every day you hear of two or three accidents and four or five people dying? If you look at explosions, they are happening. If you look at HR policies, are there in a way the health factor is not the best. If you really look at even process optimization, if you look at now the seventh code, which is the security code, that's going to play a big role as well. Now, if you put all this together, companies growing in an irresponsible manner actually give a lot of bad name. In the chemical industry, what happens is we are not disconnected. In corner of UP, there is a small accident with isocyanate, some compound or something. It's not only India, the whole world gets affected. And that, I think, chemical industry needs to realize. At ICC, we have realized this. We really want to put it all together. We want to spread the word, and not only the word, but actually offer courses, offer audits, pre-audits, post-audits, raise the security level, raise the safety level, because I think if you don't do that, all accidents have a multiplier negative effect on the chemical industry. I think I leave it at that, yeah.
Thank you, sir. You have beautifully put it with respect to safety and expansion at the same time. Now I request Mr. S. Ganeshan, sir, to speak.
Yeah, thank you. I'll just quickly sum up. Now, as I showed, if the economy is to grow fast, the attention of the government policymakers has to turn to the chemical industry. Much promised ease of doing business is yet to come to our industry. Right from day one, and even commissioning a plant on a daily basis, we run into several regulatory bottlenecks. So it's time for the policymakers in Delhi to have an open mind and address the problems that are keeping the growth of the industry much less than what it can be, what it ought to be. Now, even if you recall the data, I do not know whether it is already in public domain, known to many people, that the India's merchandise export is now led by chemicals, not by any other sector. And if you dissect the data, as I showed in the slide, it's $45 billion, number one, the merchandise export. And if you dissect it, just three sectors, that is generic pharma, generic pesticides, and dyes and pigments. These three segments alone account for close to 60% of $45 billion. And there is tremendous opportunity. But de-bottlenecking of the archaic regulatory policies is a must. If the debottlenecking occurs, then I think growth, nobody can stop. It's going to be truly India's growth story and India's chemical industry's growth story. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ganeshan, for beautifully putting it. Ease of doing business and Atmanirbhar Bharat will automatically happen. Now I request Sarnav to give his comments.
Yes, thank you. So I would broadly sum up because I think the factors that stand out probably. Yes, can you hear me?
Your voice is a bit inaudible, so if you can speak closer to the mic.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, so just wanted to, sum up that, mostly everything has been mentioned. So the focus areas are, of course, responsible care. So looking at safety, then support from the regulators on, on the ease of the business front, faster clearances and also better infrastructure, all these things. And finally, I think the other growth factors would be, of course, the shift in the supply chain that are going to happen through, de-risking across the board, not only on the overseas side, but also additionally in the domestic markets as players try to reduce the dependence on imports as their raw material, imports of their raw material. Also, factors, if taken care of and executed closely by both the industry participants as well as with support from the regulators, would drive this segment, which is basically the building blocks of all other end industries, and would actually cater to the need of the Indian populace and as well as of the global sourcing companies. So that's all from my side. Back to you, Praveen.
Thank you, Sarnav. I will take another 2 to 3 minutes from all our panelists. And my request would be if you can speak in one line only, what should be your ask from the government? One point from each of the panelists, starting with Mr. S. Ganeshan.
What should be the what?
What should be your ask from the government for becoming Atmanirbhar Bharat? What should be your ask from the government?
As I said, it's actually we really have to contemporize our regulatory policies. I'll give one example. The deep sea discharge norms, as followed in India, are much stricter and unnecessarily so compared to US EPA norms. So can we think of introducing US EPA norms for deep sea discharge? This itself will lead to, number one, enhanced chemical production and also cut down the unnecessary cost of treating the effluents. This is one thing that we should look at on priority as far as chemical industry is concerned. Yeah.
Mr. Ravi Kapoor, sir.
Yeah, I think Ganeshan it's his passion project, the deep sea discharge. So, and I agree with him. But if I say that if it's one thing that we have to ask, I would request the government first to recognize chemical industry for the importance that it deserves, number one. So give it a status to say that there is a multiplier of 4 times and give it that status. So that's number one. And along with that, declare a chemical policy. And that chemical policy will take care or should take care of all these issues, whether it is deep sea discharge, whether it is single window clearance, whether it is land reform, whether it is availability of other infrastructure. But declare these 2 things, and then I think we are in the game.
True.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Adnan Ahmed, sir.
Yeah, I think similar to what Ravi said, that I would say we need a clear chemical policy from the government of India, which is currently in draft form since 2007. So it would be great to be able to issue that and finalize that. And similar to what China did, few decades ago, and which has helped them grow from 6% of the world's manufacturing to 40%. And at the same time, we have grown from 2% to 3%. So I think that's really something that we need. And, you know, just speed up our approvals and so on and help us to grow rather than, you know, give us ease of doing business in the chemical industry, which right now is pathetic.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Suhad, right?
I think the one point I would seek is very, very fast clearances, because when we work on projects, generally the teams tend to put 3 years for clearance of a project. So if we are looking at 3 years clearance of project and then again 3-4 years for project execution, it becomes so very quick clearance window for clearance of projects is very important, at least for chemical industry, because it involves environment clearances also. And most of other panelists also touch about the same thing. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Rajiv Kumar, sir.
So taking cue from Mr. Ahmed and Mr. Kapoor, that government chemical policy. So this is what actually, as on today, what is happening, that government thinks like a chemical industry, like a black box. Just generalize everything for everybody, don't understand what is the need of each segment it is there. If there is a clear policy, what government is looking in the long term in the chemical segment, and then understand each segment of that, and then prepare the policy for this segment. This is what we envisage. This will be our support from the government. This is what we are looking from the industry. Then all these things will be done. Otherwise, whatever is required by the petrochemical, and the same thing you are giving to the dye manufacturer also, cannot be generalized like that. So this is the reason that we are only 2% of the GDP in the chemical industry. I can tell you, you take all the developed nation, it is there. It is the large share of the chemical industry in their GDP. Easily from 2%, we can go to 10% if there is a clarity in what government wants to do as a complete integrated chemical policy and what they are looking from the industry. So industry player understand the what is expected from the government, how they can chart out for the long term. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I would like to thank the all my speakers for the insight and providing their valuable time for this conference. And now I would request the audience to shoot their questions on the chat window, which is the Q&A section at the bottom of your page. Please send as many as questions so that we can take it from our speakers. We will have 15 minutes for the Q&A. I think we have shot by another 3 minutes. We have 16:03 right now. We will take the first set of questions. And the first set of questions, there are 4 questions. I will ask my panelist to respond to each one of them in very short and brief. The first is from Mr. Ravi Raghavan, achievable goals of reducing dependency on China. Majority of them was being spoken about by our speakers. Mr. Neeraj Karale talks about the CapEx plans. Mr. Chintan talks about, is there any plan to initiate manufacturing of those chemicals in India, the raw materials that they were talking about. And Mr. Rajendra Gogri, he's talking about what should be our strategy or policy to initiate increased availability of basic chemicals and intermediates to become self-reliant. So one is on reducing dependency on China, the second on CapEx plan, the third on initiating manufacturing, whether it is front end or back end, and the fourth is on availability of basic chemicals and intermediates.
See, if I may step in here, just to try to answer part of it at least.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, just part of it is that another thought which comes is that any project which is going to be done, which replaces an import, and also is also the first company to do so, as let's say as just a first project, which is very easy to do. That means if the product is not being made in India and somebody wants to make it, thereby replacing imports, the government should give a special status. Now they can decide how they want to incentivize. There should be fast permission, fast track. Maybe they give a tax break for the first 2 years, 3 years, whatever. But this is a classic case where you can enhance, let's say, the whole country's capability, stop the imports, get the company to start making the product, get the technology, develop the technology. And there are cases, and I'm happy to report our company is doing 2 such projects that we are kind of just going into it. There's nobody else making these 2 products and we are putting up the plant there. But if it was announced as a policy or part of the policy and part of an incentivization program, I think that a lot more people would come in, you know, and should be done quickly.
So I just want to add to that, Ravi. I think, you know, similarly, we also have products which are mainly for export, and we are, you know, we're able to be competitive on export. And to just even look at what Mr. Gogri is asking, you know, it's a very big question what he's asking. And I do not think it can be answered in any separate way unless the government has a clear policy for chemicals, because it means bringing in big investments, big spending. So companies like mine, a global company, when they have an option of investing in China or investing in India, it's very difficult for me to pull that investment in India. And in spite of that difficulty, we brought a lot of investment here. So there is an eagerness to come to India, but India is not a friendly place to come and invest in. It's not a friendly place to come and start working. And the management in India, all of us, we sort of hide all the problems from everybody else to show them that actually, you know, it's not that bad. But we know the reality of how painful it is. So whether it's availability of intermediates, availability of upstream materials, whether it's availability of infrastructure to go to the ports and so on. And on CapEx, you're talking about scale. We can only get scale if we modernize our industry. And we have to be able to look at Indian demand and global demand. Without that, scale is not going to come. And you're right, because China has grown because of scale. Absolutely. And everything they did, a bit like Reliance Industries done in India in their segments, you know, they put in scale well before the demand in India, and then everything fills up, you know. And that's what all of us need to be able to do through, you know, a good, clear policy that supports us.
Yeah, how many billion dollar companies in the chemical industry do we have in India? You know, if you look at it, it's too few, basically.
Yes, it is.
Regarding the CapEx plan, that whatever happened before March, all of us, I think majority of the chemical industry had a beautiful CapEx plan. It was all going good and people were really working the big, big projects on that. Now suddenly the COVID has come in. And now we are wondering that what will happen new that. What we have to do that not to really shaken by this. This will be a short to medium term only. And today, whatever we do, we continue with our CapEx plan. So within 6 months, when we will see, there will be demand is back. And that time, if we don't have volume to supply, then we will miss the bus for the growth. So this is the right time. Just forget about what exactly happening as on today. But whatever the investment plan, the CapEx plan execution, it is there. We must continue with that so that our growth story continues, though there was a little bit break in that for a few months, but we should not be really disturbed by that.
If there are no more speakers who would like to budge in, I have another set of four questions, sir. One is with respect to issue of safety. How have developing countries done it and how can India do it better? Anyway, ICC is running a program on safety in a big way. The second is on availability of feedstock from Hemant Tambe. Issue of safety was from Natarajan G. Then the third was export incentive from the policymakers or from the government. This is from Harsh Bhatia. Dr. Rashmi talks about draft chemical safety and rules 20XX to be finalized. And the fifth one was on coping with COVID disruption, which has already been answered. So four parts, one on the issue of safety, the second on availability of feedstock, the third on export incentives from the policymakers, and the fourth is on draft chemical safety rules. Over to you, over to the speakers. Anybody can buy it.
I'll take the first one, Praveen, the one on safety. And let me just say that you cannot compare safety for us, the challenge for us, to what the Europeans have done. And simply because European society has a much higher focus on safety and value for safety and discipline than we do in India. I mean, let's be realistic. You look outside, we have a very fatalistic view on safety. Okay, humko kuch nahi hoga. I am okay, nothing will happen to me. I don't need a helmet. I don't need seat belts. I can drive like a maniac and nothing will happen to me. During COVID, I don't need a mask because I am above the law. And that kind of stuff. So in our companies, we have to create an ecosystem with a very different safety awareness compared to what is outside our gate. So that makes the challenge huge. So I'm not saying that it's not challenging. It's hugely challenging, and that's why it requires all of us in the industry to put safety as your number one priority. It is number one above safe, above profit, above everything. Number one priority has to be safety. And if we understand that, all of us, then we will make, you know, small steps to move in that direction. I think that's really what the need of the hour is.
Yeah, if I can take the incentives, you know, just a quick word on the incentive, Praveen.
Yes, sir.
The as far as we've recently gone on record, we, you know what I think government also needs to do is to react fast. For example, I can talk about my industry, but there are 2,000 items which are on the list. And on the 20th of March, the Chinese, what they did is they increased the amount of refund that was given on their VAT. Now, effectively, what happens is, say there was a line of chemistry products where the refund was 4%, they increased it to 13%. So effectively, from one day to the other, apart from their currency devaluation, what happens is, straight away, a Chinese exporter or a Chinese exporter into India or a Chinese exporter into other countries has straight away an advantage between 5 to 10%. And that has happened on more than 2,000 products. And here the government needs to react fast. Now, whether you do it, now there are WTO restrictions, we understand all that. And you know, there are very smart people who can figure that out. But if you don't do that, say a segment like pigments, you'll have a 13%, it was zero refund, and there is now 13%. And you have that kind of disadvantage. Imagine competing with the Chinese in the European market at a 13% disadvantage, you're not in the game at all. You know, you start losing business which you have built up, or market share which you have built up over the last 10 years. I mean, these kind of issues are issues that they have to react fast. And here is something where the incentive would play a role. Normally, I would say that I'm not for SOPs. You know, you compete, you fight, you know, you get your cost structure down, you get your technologies in. But in this case, I think you sometimes need a helping hand there.
Looking at a safety point, actually, what Mr. Emma said sometime back, it is there that it is a part of our the chemical manufacturing, and we should take it as a cost. But I have my own perception that the safety is basically in the beginning, we need investment, we have to do so many things over there. But actually, in long term, you don't see it is not a cost. It is a facilitator to run our plant smoothly. There are many accidents happen inside the chemical plant if there is no safety. All these, the big explosion and all that, what we hear, it is just the big scale level that what we hear. If there is no safety, there are many accidents happening small and medium. And what happens? We have to stop the plant. And then for production losses, there are many other problems are there. If we stop all those things, then productivity and the efficiency improves a lot, which in terms of pays for whatever we have spent on safety. So safety, what I say, it is must. That is the first thing which we should look. If we go for the chemical, which anybody looks at, the chemical means danger. So if it is a danger, the first place, if we have to run our factories, our plant smoothly, then safety is the first place what we have to focus.
I would also would like to add on safety, because this is one of the very critical areas for, especially for chemical industries and chemical businesses. And also, we have MSMEs, and there have been accidents last within 1.5 months itself. There are 4 accidents which have happened. So safety, it is like, for example, a very, very critical area, at least for us and our group, which we are considering. It's part of our value system. And it has to move from where we are talking about the equipment safety, where we are talking about PPEs, and where we are talking about machineries and other things. So we have to possibly look at newer areas of process safety, missed incidents, behavioral safety, observations, like proactively observation, how many potential safety hazards we have, how people's behavior is there, whether they are doing the process effectively, whether they are using PPEs. And once we have observations and those studies, how do we try to ensure that it gets into the culture of each and every person, whether our own employees, our own contractors, or our logistics service providers. And I think now a lot of professional agencies have also come up and started working in this area. But this is one area I agree with all other panelists, Mr. Ahmed, Mr. Rajiv, everybody talked about it. It's a very, very critical area for all of us.
Mr. Ganeshan, if you have anything to say, sir.
Yeah, I would say something on this export front. The question is, the government will definitely, we can, from the chemical industry, we can easily assure the government that the chemical exports can easily move up from $45 billion to over $100 billion in about 3 years' time, provided there is the right policy facilitation. I think this is one message that we can give through this forum also. The sky is the limit to increase our export. 1/3 of our country's merchandise export can indeed come from chemical sector alone in the short term, provided chemical industry is recognized as a growth engine. Now, this has to dawn on the minds of policymakers. Thank you.
Sir, I will take another set of three questions. One is on how Indian chemical companies will prefer to go for high price indigenous raw materials. The second is with respect to this question is addressed to Mr. Ganeshan on how agrochemical companies are coping up with COVID disruption. This is from Oliver Baptist. And the third is the role of merchant exporters for contributing to exports of specialty chemicals for next 2 to 3 years from Samriksha. So if Ganeshan sir, if you can talk about and then we can open this to other panelists.
Sure. Now the question, as I understand, is the impact of COVID on agrochemical industry, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now there is no negative impact at all. It is unlikely. So what happened in India is that most of the migrant laborers, for 2 months ago, returned to their villages. The first thing they started doing is to spend time in their own farmlands. So that has in turn resulted in huge expansion in Kharif sowing area. I don't know if you have seen the figures. In fact, it has doubled. So we have not experienced any serious disruption in our business except logistics disruption. But as on the demand side is concerned, we don't foresee any slackening of demand. On the contrary, there would be a tremendous demand in the perishable segment, that is fruits and vegetables. That's what we foresee for the coming months. And even the last year, as I shared in the beginning of my talk, India's agricultural GDP substantially increased. To quote the numbers, it went up from $396 billion to over $418 billion to over $450 billion. Massive jump in our agriculture production last year. And it's unlikely to be the same current year because the first few months are, but the consumption level is a bit down as far as agri output is concerned. But we do not see any major setback, number one, internal market. Export market continues as it is. So these are the two driving factors supporting the agrochemical industry.
Praveen, I'd like to take the question on merchant exporters.
Okay, sir.
So here, you know, one observation I've had for a few years, if I look at really the other countries, if I say US or Europe or even Far East, the merchant exporters have a certain role, which is very important to play. But what we find is that, the merchant exporter role in India is a bit different than we see it. Which means that if I was to advise or even just compare, I think what is required in specialty chemicals is that merchant exporters can bring much more value than what they bring today. Today, it's more like a trading and distributing, function. But if you really go deep into it in US and in Europe, the merchant exporter has testing facilities. They actually identify products. They go marketing technically the products. And in India, it is so perfect because a lot of times MSMEs are not really able to get access into certain customers. And then the MSMEs don't have they have regulatory, a lacuna of regulatory knowledge or regulatory people. And all these services, if the merchant exporters bring in, I think they would add real value and then they grow in size. So that was one value. The second is, of course, on what focus they should have is that it's obvious and a no-brainer that, you have health-related issues. There are deals available for all kind of manufacturers and merchant exporters today. health and hygiene related issues are the most important today. I mean, you get ideas, if you get products which are coated with, whatsoever resin systems or whatever systems, for COVID related hygiene wear. For example, yesterday I heard a deal, and they're all in massive size, 100 crore deal from the US that a trading company in Delhi is doing. So these kind of issues, I think if they concentrate and bring value by putting in just not the trading and administrative knowledge, but going beyond it, going into the technical space and the regulatory space.
I want to add to Mr. Kapoor very important areas that merchant exports is not only trading of material, because in specialty chemicals, a lot of customer intimacy and customer customization is also involved. So how much they are able to actually get into there and how much they are able to actually coordinate between company and the manufacturer and the consumer for these customizations, and how those product development they can add the value, and also the infrastructure support which they can give into the exporting countries rather than here, because serviceability is also one of the key areas for specialty chemicals. So how all those loose ends also could be tied up. Then if once those things are there, the merchants, exporters could become a very important link in the entire business.
So if there are no more comments, Swarna, would you like to give some comment? Swarna?
Yes, hi. I just wanted to add just one line to this about this export incentive. I think this, if taken, would make us hugely competitive in the global market. Exports, so we already export a large share of specialty chemicals, and I think we are, as a country, we are very well placed to continue doing that. We already have good connections with global sourcers in terms of our products through our R&D capabilities, and there are several contract manufacturing initiatives in place also. So all these things together could bode very well for our exports, and would eventually result in us in the scale that we are looking for. So I think this is a key area that we need to focus on. Thank you.
So with Swarnav comments, I would like to thank all my speakers for their insight and providing their valuable time for this e-conference. I would also like to thank the audiences for their overwhelming response. There were around more than 200 people who participated in this conference today and on posting questions throughout the course of this e-conference. I would like to thank each one of you on behalf of ICN or Indian Chemical News for being a part of this interactive e-conference that we organized for the first time. And I hope that you will have got some valuable inputs on how India will accelerate their growth story. Indian Chemical News will host a series of e-conference in consultation with the industry. So I would request, if you can reach us to any one of us, you can reach us to me as Praveen@IndianChemicalNews.com by giving us your valuable feedback so that we can come up with better e-conference topics so that we can solve the industry. And I think all our speakers gave wonderful insights on what the government needs to do, what the industry needs to do, and what the ancillary industries need to do. With this, I would thank everybody once again. A big clap to all of our speakers and all our delegates. And so this is Praveen Prashant signing off for now, and we will meet you live in the next e-conference.